Well, as always, the action never stops. Because we're flying along, we might as well keep on going in that fashion. It's game three and group one, or rather, excuse me, group two, the first game. It's, of course, another European versus North American matchup. And this time, perhaps the North Americans' best chance today. Obviously, no offense to Liquid. They had the stand-in, but now CLG, who've also had some good performances on European soil lately, go up against a team that, as Semler's dubbed it, has been a little bit questionable lately. A little bit of a struggle for the Danish side. To bring them on the stage, we'll start off on the left, as always. And interestingly enough, and we'll get to this in a minute, they've started on the left side. They know it's the winning side. CLG, the first Americans to be the first on the stage. Give it up for CLG. What's going on, Hazed? I noticed, by the way, that you don't have your man bun. There was a bet with Moses. I know you said it was voluntary, you got rid of it, but I'm hoping, and you can confirm or deny, that you're not like Samson the Great, where now your superpowers in game are gone.
No comment on that. I will say, though, that Moses missed his opportunity.
I think he did, too. I think he did. But you know what, though? Like, I think he was, like, just really out to get you as a vendetta. Like, we're up here talking about hair and cutting it. He can't even do that, so I don't understand why you'd be a little bit upset by that. But let's start off. You guys, famous for playing to the level of your opponent in some ways, always putting up double digits, close games. Doesn't matter if you're playing Fnatic, doesn't matter if you're playing Dignitas, doesn't matter who you're playing, it's always close. Today, you guys got to put your best foot forward. You know that they've been on a bit of a slump. Anything you guys come into expecting, I guess, in this best of three?
Hopefully some better play now that we have a coach on our side. He's really been helping us. He hasn't been with us very long, maybe a week or so, but he's already given us a lot of valuable information. Hopefully we can stop playing to the level of our opponents and just like play our own game and take games instead of, you know, having all these crazy comebacks or crazy losses. So hopefully we can be more consistent.
You say it hasn't been that much time with the coach, but is there already any mid-round calling, any, you know, on-the-fly adaptation, or is he simply doing demo review and helping you guys with strats out of the game?
Everything. He helps us with everything. Right now, it's more of an observe type thing. When we're in game, he wants to see how we operate on our own, and then if he sees like a major mistake, he'll point it out and tell us to, you know, fix it. So,
absolutely. Now, you guys have had again some recent success with your roles. Obviously, coming into this as one of right now without Cloud9 here, obviously the two flagship teams in US, probably the best chances. Is there anything again, focusing on XTSM, questionable team question mark, is there anything that you guys have notified about them? Or because you guys haven't actually played them all that much, so is there anything that you expect to see from them, like map veto wise, you know, scouting report, or is it not even going to be any strat game?
I won't comment on that.
God, I'm trying. Well, I won't pull teeth any longer then. I'm just going to get you out of my face because you're not helping me. But good luck. I'll let you join your team. It's going to be an awesome series. I finally think we'll see a pretty back-and-forth matchup. That said, though, we do have to introduce the next team. And much like Prince, these guys are now known as a symbol. Give it up for Team Question Mark. I love it. They're free to do their hype. I mean, like, hello, how are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Oh, God, here, I can already tell. Speaking of hair with Hazed, I noticed at Fragbite you had a tough time against SK because you didn't have the product in your hair, but you're looking better today. Is that like Crims, your magic is in the hair?
No, not really. I just have a good hair day, yeah.
Dupree cut my hair last night. Do you remember that?
Yeah. He's a certified hairdresser, so it's fine, yeah.
Top troll, Dupree, top troll. Look, let's get to it. Straightforward. We're not going to talk about all this nonsense on the shirt. We'll get to that eventually. We'll all find out at the same time. But let's talk about the in-game performances. They've been a little bit of a struggle as of late, arguably since Cluj, when it kind of started slipping away. What do you guys have to do to fix it?
I mean, we've spoken a lot, and I think we've figured out our problems. Our problems like go way back before Cluj. We just won tournaments because of individual performances, and we like kind of forgot to work on the mistakes that we had, and they just build up now and like became more and more, and we know how to fix it and we're working on it, so it's fine for us.
Good. Well, that's good to hear, obviously. Now, individually, you guys have been together for a while at this point in time. You know, there's been roster changes for other teams that have paid off. Right now, the arguable one was Daisy. He's gone. You know, you guys have to focus. You know, Zipex has stepped up considerably. You've been stepped up, I would say, up to the major as the best player, arguably, in the world. It's kind of slipped away. How have you been feeling specifically right now with this roster? Is the motivation gone? Is it there for you? I'm calling you out, basically.
Yeah, I know what you say. I mean, like, we have been together for a year now, and we have spoken of roster changes before and has been out in the open, but we have taken a more open approach, like, towards the team, where we just speak with each other, because if you underperform for 2 months, yeah, you underperform, but you can still come back. As you saw with Sibix, we had a conversation with him, and he's just starting to get rolling. Like, he's been rolling for 4 months now, and I believe that the approach we take is the better one, because you see the hot fixes they made with NVS, and they have the honeymoon period, and you speak about that with every team. And I think working like through a slump like in the team is better than just doing the hot fix and doing a change.
Interesting stuff. Yeah, that's definitely something that's been proven. Well, I'm gonna wish you luck. I'll let you get in game, get warmed up, because we've got to get warmed up as viewers as well. You can walk. You don't have to stay with me. It's fine. You can if you want, but I prefer you didn't, to be honest. I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. But it is interesting that, like he's saying, work through it as a team, work through the slump, because both of these teams right now are two of the most stable rosters in CSGO, which means we've got lots to talk about, and that does mean we'll talk about it over on the desk. Machine, I'm gonna stay nice to you this time, bro. I love you.
Yeah, you're all right yourself, but it's not a desk. You need to stop calling it a desk. This is kind of like a, it's a
Machine.
Circular.
Machine, Sato just reached out to you, man.
Yeah, but we decided we're going to do this whole kind of like hot and cold thing, like the Katy Perry thing. He'll be nice, I'll be nasty. Mm. We'll see. Either
Sato
way,
just can't catch a break.
Much love to Matt, and we have to talk about this one a little further. Good, great interview as well. Kind of seeing a little bit of the soul of Device and the soul of TSM. He said, you know, just basically stating that we are very open about our roster discussions. We have talked about them in the past, and we basically approach ZipX and we're like, yo, dude, or ZipNix, excuse me, whichever one.
Zip.
Oh, that is the smart way of doing
Safe
it.
Safe bet.
Nice.
One of the names that was come up that was pretty good on Twitter was Caught in the Zipper.
Caught in the Zipper.
For their new team name.
That's actually not bad, yeah.
It's pretty good.
I asked him, I was in Dubai, and I was like, dude, come on. Like, what is your name? He's like, I don't really care anymore. Yeah. I just don't care.
Yeah, that's what he told me, right? The first time, because this was a while ago. I went up to ask him when this first started.
Yeah.
And he's like, actually, I'm just trolling the journalist now. Like, I don't care.
Yeah, and now I've noticed that Henry G is exclusively calling him ZipX.
Yeah,
and I'm
they
like,
are.
Damn, you've committed to that, dude. I respect that.
You know, the OG are going to just keep calling him ZipX, because that's what we've been calling him for 3 years. So I don't know, man.
We'll rock it.
We're not wrong, Anders.
I'm pretty sure it was apparently it was Anders' fault. You were the one that went ZipNix, and that's where it came from.
Well, I asked him initially. We asked him the first time around and said, like,
you went ZipNix.
ZipNix good. And he was like, yeah, that's it. It's like, cool.
Okay, there
but
we
later
go.
Later on, he changes way. We can't.
It changes tune.
Very indecisive.
Let's set the scene. Let's set the scene for this one. TSM, the story has been, and it will continue to be, this whole kind of, we don't know, what is this, a discussion we have around TSM where it always seems like they're regarded as a top three, top two team, top two roster. I just called them TSM like 9 times, didn't I? Excuse me, TQM.
Doesn't matter, though. Just call them TSM, because that's what we all know them as.
X-TSM.
Yeah. I mean, we all know them as TSM.
Yes.
But they always no new TSM roster.
This is the mindset, you know? They come in, they just seem to have the struggle to finish. They seem to be, you know, the kings of semifinals. And I think that's a discussion point for us here. Blue, we'll start with you. It's nice to hear your thoughts on European CS.
I mean, overall, I think, again, it's just been a really big struggle for them over the previous 2 weeks. We just haven't, at least on LAN matches, online matches really haven't seemed to have been affected that much. At least coming into this one, they still have been one of the top teams, but on a lot of these LAN matches, they just haven't been as strong as they have been in some of the previous weeks. And even going back to, you know, DreamHack winner and Fragmite, once again, they kind of bomb out there.
They are genuinely singing the Macarena. I just want everyone to know that. They're taking a leaf out of Fnatic's book and see how effective singing songs can be.
I just have to say that these guys are very fortunate that they were able to clear out all their online matches for the league before that slump kicked in.
Yeah,
because they just dominated that online portion. Like, nobody
could
touch them.
Top of the table.
Straight to the top. Right, and that was when they were going, you know, they had like something crazy, like they were in like the high 20s, like 27-0 or something like that, just like a sick map streak.
Yeah.
And that was right when they were playing most of their EPL matches, right? And then after that, like super slumped.
Do you reckon any of it has to do with the organization kind of, you know, drama that was going on?
I mean, I put that forward.
That could be something.
I put that forward saying, you know, like they didn't have, when there's conflict like that and you're not really sure where your home is going to be and you have to worry about this as a pro player because your career is so short, so you want everything to be as smooth as possible. Mm. And you have, well, CS is a little bit long because we have like guys who have been in it for 10 years, right?
Yeah.
But like right now, everything is going up. It's going up and you want to be in the right place at the right time, right? So that might put a lot of pressure on you mentally. Mm. Question is, you know, a pro player needs to be able to check all that background out when he gets into a game. And so it takes a little bit of the wind out of the sails when you try and bring up that argument, because it's just like, they get into the server, they should just be focused on that and nothing else.
Anders? Yeah, I saw you had a point to make.
Yeah, similar thought. I mean, I think it could be a point, but I also feel like they should be able to sort of transcend that at some point. I mean, but I think it's just down to, like, they had a bit of a break at some point. Like, they had a two-week break, yeah. And then...
After Cluj, I think?
Yeah, after Cluj. And then they kind of tried to get back right into and dig a lot of practice, just went to a lot of events like that. And I think for them, it's also, like, now the year is ending, and they just got to, like... I mean, I think that they'll come back next year and be much stronger. Yeah. You know, now they're playing CLG, and...
That leads us into a nice one.
You don't want to end the year by losing to a team you definitely should be beating. So,
absolutely. And I mean, you've touched on CLG. I think you've got a lot of kind of interesting things to discuss there. Of course, they discussed it in the interview there. Matt, being master of his craft, did bring up the idea that they've got a new coach filling in filling in those shoes there, and that's going to be an interesting one. We still, though, the roster is on screen, and the team that seems like they're always capable of keeping it close, keeping it exciting for North America, but only for so long.
I think there's a moment where you have to think, if you're a European team coming into this tournament, there's like just a little bit of added pressure because you don't want to be the European team to lose to a North American team.
Yeah, I think that's valid. Like, yeah,
you know, you're like, we cannot lose to a North American team. Sorry, flat out, right? So maybe that's just a little bit more there, you know, on the mind as they're getting into the game. You know, JDM looks like he's very focused right now, you know, trying to...
What, doing his drivers?
Really, dialing it up. You know,
editing his South American team, on the other hand.
Oh,
well, yeah, exactly.
It's like I like to say South America is best America.
South America, I mean, is the best CS nation.
You're pretty much correct. So.
I mean, DreamHack winner, right? We're going to get to see Luminosity later, guys. Yeah. Well, guys, to you guys, obviously you guys know. But that DreamHack winner run was a thing of legend. Like, amazing.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to keep talking about them a lot more later on. I do want to come back to Peter. Let's talk about that for a second, because, of course, Peter, you know, sat behind NIP for a bit as well. He's now taking the coaching role over. I saw his tweet, and I was kind of low at question marks. Suddenly popped up. I was like, hang on a second. He was saying, like, oh, just heading off to North America, about to make an announcement. Then he turns up as the coach for CLG. I'd love to know just opening thoughts when you saw that announcement made. I mean, how much of an impact can a coach have on, like, a European presence in a North American team?
I think this is going to be a really good thing for them overall as a team, because I think Moses would disagree with me on this to a certain degree, but I think overall CLG, at least out of all the teams today that are playing, Liquid are probably going to be able to contest them a little bit more once they have their full roster, but CLG probably has one of the better chances out of the three purely North American teams that we have here to create an upset versus XTSM at this point. And now that they have a coach to really solidify this roster together as a single unit as well, I think that can help out immensely. Mm.
I mean, the question always is how much does a coach do for a team? I mean, how much of an impact is he making? Because it's such a huge discussion.
Well, okay, real quick, there's a way to turn that around. Okay. Where it's like, how much does the team do for the coach?
You have to elaborate. You've lost me.
No, well, because think about it from this way. Like, the expression, the frustration that Natu expressed when he was trying to coach.
I'm there now.
And, you know, and so it's like, you can be the best coach in the world. You can have all the strats. You can be like, this is what you guys need to focus on. Yeah. Clearly, I'm watching it happen like a train wreck. And, you know, you just got to put the brakes on a little bit. And that train wreck, you know, you just barely make that curve. Right, okay, well, we'll calm down a little bit. But how much can a team actually do? They need to be able to cooperate. Mm. They need to be able to actually take what that coach is saying and apply it to the game.
It comes down to Sean again. Sean said it just before in the previous segment. Respect. Sean. You have to have the respect for your coach. And I don't think that's something Natu had when he was doing that.
Or have the confidence in yourself. Because if you're afraid of what's actually happening on that server, and, you know, the coach could be telling you exactly what to do, but you need to be in that state of mind to be able to act on it. And so that's going to be a little bit of a mystery as well. CLG have been a bit of a punching bag race recently. That's no lie. You know, they've been frustrated. Mm. And so... Well, you know, are they going to be able to take what that fine Swedish gentleman behind them is saying and actually apply it in the game?
I think in that regard, it actually does matter that Peter's from Europe, because I think there's more of a chance that they will respect him. If you're NIP, like, you might just think about, like, the legacy of NIP, and then try to think of, like, what person would you put in that the NIP players would, like, you know, respect. Now, I actually think they should have definitely respected Natu, because he's obviously very smart. But I think maybe their minds were in a different place at that point in time. I mean, there were other problems there.
Yeah.
I don't think it was just like the NIP players were like, well, we don't care about Natu, let's just move on. I think there's a lot of other things going on. But I think for someone like Peter, I think he could come in here. And I think, generally speaking, the CLG guys are pretty open. I've had a lot of conversations with them about things, and they don't seem to have, like, huge egos that sort of, you know, would drive that away. I mean, whenever you talk about, like, the mistakes they make, they seem to take that pretty seriously.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I'm going to go ahead and start with you, Blue, when we talk about the vetoes, because we've got maps to talk about. And this is going to be an interesting one. I mean, like, there's maps you definitely don't want to be playing against TQM, and you can see the veto there. Does that kind of read as a story that favors the boys in blue for the CLG?
I actually think so to a certain degree. The first map pick they get, Mirage, is actually a really good steal for them because it's actually one of their better maps. Statistically speaking, it is their best map in terms of just purely the percentage of times that they win this one. So this is a great pick for them to steal away from the guys on XTSM. Inferno, not so much, so that could be a rough one. But the third map, Train, as well, they've had a lot of really good matchups there. So this could potentially end up going to three maps.
Okay. That's what we've been hearing across the board, actually. I mean, you kind of got the same kind of thoughts with Goose. Like, this is a good potential three-mapper.
When you talk about the reasoning behind their pick on Mirage, the first thing that comes to mind is just, like, CLG, that's their map, or the map that you expect to see them have good results on. And so this is more, like, I really like that, and I'm wondering if this is PETA's influence again, right? Because I like that a team, instead of trying to play a weak map of their opponent, they try and play their strong map in which they're confident on. Mm. So even if their opponent is good on it, at least they know what they're doing on the map and they know what works and they can get results rather than trying to be like out mind game yourself a la NiP, where it's like, oh, but we'll play their weak map and you don't know what you're doing either. And then it just turns into this scrum and then it comes down to aim, and then that's never fun when you're talking about European versus NA, right? Mm. So. I think that Mirage is actually, like, we could have three because that's CLG's best chance right there to actually take it to that third map.
Yeah, and I just want to kind of touch on individuals as well for the boys of both CLG and TQM. Whenever I think TQM, TQM. Whenever we talk about when we talk about them and their play on Mirage, I just think Carrigan and holding middle on CT side. Like this, I don't know why, but it just feels like he sets a trend so much.
Well, we have the main spokesman here. Yeah. Carrigan, op mid.
Carrigan, I don't have my wristband with me this time, sorry.
You're an advocate for it as well.
Carrigan is very strong on that middle. It's been more difficult for him recently because of all the jump script smokes that are coming out, which means...
Let's not start that discussion again. No. We're going to get lost for another 15 minutes.
Orping middle Mirage is a huge problem now. It's really hard to do. Carrigan's still very good at, obviously, so he might be my player to watch on the XTSM roster here. Every time you mention the team, you have to mention the Vice anyway. On the other team, I think, you know, JDM is like a counterpart to that. Actually, more than anything, I'm really curious to see how much... we've got actually a Finesse sitting in the middle here, but either way, when Cutler was in charge of the team and everything, and he was doing a lot of the leading there, he had some really good anti-strats. Some of the European teams they played on Inferno. I hope that they're going to do something similar here. I want to see like a good, really good terrorist side coming out of them where they have a lot of good calls. Because we know now they can put in the work. We know that they are like willing to do that.
And this is where it gets very interesting for TSM, because we've had this discussion many times in the past as far as, you know, like this focus on Carrigan with the alt mid, and they seem to really need him to have an impact with that AWP. Once that got figured out, TSM a few months ago had to, relearn their CT then, add to their toolbox. So they still have Carrigan mid, and that's always a threat, but they've had to actually improve past that, and now they have more options. So when it comes to these, you know, quick smokes mid, they can't necessarily rely on Carrigan all the time. They've actually kind of had like a step ahead of everybody else because they've already developed a game that isn't so focused on that op mid control. So, it's not going to be easy for CLG. This is still their best chance, I think. But, you know, TSM are a big beast on this map.
I think the one thing overall that XTSM also have to look at when it comes to their T side is just the innovation of strategy. The last time I managed to spectate them playing on this map, it seemed very dry, very ill-rehearsed, and there wasn't a whole lot of innovation going on. It was just the same couple of strats being reused over and over again. And their opponent, which, if I remember correctly, I think it was E-Frag in that matchup, they were actually able to beat them up pretty easily and take the map with, like, less than 10 rounds going on the board for XTSM. Mm.
And I mean, the point I just want to come back to before we completely deviate from it was you said, you know, with all these smokes now kind of making holding middle difficult on CT side with an AWP or not, what are the options? So I've been thinking about this, like you've got, I mean, like aggressive play, which sometimes you see North Americans like for no reason do CLG or a team that spring to mind actually that just throw like three CTs up middle one round for no apparent reason. But like, what else have you got in your arsenal? Like, I mean, a fast peek from like short, I mean, what?
You're going for coordinated pushes on the extremities, I think. That's always why it's a joy to watch Mirage. It's always been one of my favorite maps to watch, flat out.
That's the only pin I own.
Because you have... See? Because, well, me, it was like LGB, the first LGB lineup that, you know, basically I fell in love with Mirage watching them play because they were so good at that, at hitting the timings of knowing when to push into Palace, when to push into Pit, or push B halls. Like, just you never knew which way they were going to come. It was either up mid or on the extremities, but they were always pushing somewhere and they were always aggressive. That got figured out to an extent, and so they had to pull their game back and evolve again. But that, there's always that option on Mirage. It's really that map where it's just like you can push everywhere as CT and have an impact. Yeah. So it's all about those timings. Those timings for the pit push, I think, would be actually the big one, right? The flash over the wall, put two guys down there. Are they setting up for an A execute? No. Okay, fall back. You know, that sort of stuff is going to be key here for whoever gets to start on the CT side.
Do you think that's going to have a big impact? Do you think, you know, whoever gets to kind of start on that defense is going to be working it better?
I think CLG really need it.
More for CLG and them, right?
So, I mean, we're actually going to be looking at a pretty important knife round for the Americans.
Yeah, I think so.
And I mean, let's keep this discussion going. We are just resolving a quick monitor issue with one of the boys of CLG. So while they sort that one out, I mean, let's just delve a little further. The other two maps as well. I mean, do you have another point to make? Sorry, go.
I was actually hoping we could dive a little bit more talking about the individualistics of the members of CLG, how they perform there as well. I mean, so this is a really good question in terms just to look at how well they're going to do in this set, because if some of the key players, more specifically I'm looking at players like JDM and Tarek, if those guys come out to play today, I think there's a very strong chance they could upset in this set if it goes to that third map, and if they come out with a strong victory on map number one. However, again, those guys have been fairly inconsistent over the past few weeks, so if they're coming into this one week today, that could immediately kill those chances, and we could just see a quick 2-0 from XTSM.
This is why, you know, the CT start really needs to happen, is because they need to have a strong pistol, and they need to get JDM on that op fast, because then he's really going to be able to have an early impact on. And TSM, you know, they're goofing around, but when you see teams goofing around a lot like that, trying to like put on a show, you know, it kind of makes you think, you know, are you all there right now? Or are you just trying? Is this bravado? Or are you just trying to make us think something or make yourselves think something? Because I think if they get challenged early on, TSM, it might get a little tricky for them in the mental game, because we all know right now that they are dealing once again with that issue of throwing away games or underperforming versus opponents they should never, you know, that should never happen against.
Do you know where this leads us into for what I think might be the more interesting prediction segment that we've had so far this morning? Cool. Is going to be predictions for Mirage. Where are we seeing this one go? I mean, like, it's been pretty clear cut as of yet, but we're going into one that
because
you guys have...
It would have totally changed if Conquest had gotten a CT star, for example, on Inferno, right? You know, what we saw.
Yeah, uh-huh.
You know, so this knife for me is, like, super important. I think that CLG really need to get it. If they don't get the knife and they have to start T-side and TSM can start their wall of defense that they're famous for, I would see TSM taking the map flat out, hands down.
Okay.
But yeah, so it's like, it's kind of dependent on who gets the side. I don't know. Do you guys agree?
Do you want to do what, like, a kind of...
Well, you can't.
I guess we just have to say that TSM.
We're going to pick a side.
He's calling question mark.
Okay. I'm just going to go with TSM because they're question mark. Questionable.
I got you, August.
Yeah, thanks, man. How about you? They're gonna take this map.
Yeah, I fear it's going to be the same. So yeah, I'm going to go for question mark as well. You did bring up Tarek and JDM. I think it's absolutely true. I want to see a lot out of Cutler as well.
Yeah,
I mean, on the fragging front as well. And I think he's impressed me a lot recently.
I think he was CLG's like MVP for IEM. I mean, he was at the top of the scoreboard a lot during that one.
I will hold faith in America. I'm probably gonna regret this decision.
Okay.
But I will go with CLG for this map specifically.
Good job.
Right here, boys. Yeah.
There it is. There's a little bit of it. I mean, it is called red, white, and blue. You're obviously nearly a third of the way there already.
30%.
I got you there. Right, 33.3 recurring, actually, if we're gonna go all the way.
Well,
dropping some math bombs, but I think it's time for us to jump straight on into map one in this best of three. We're gonna see how the Americans fare the desk, or rather the couch. It's a little doubtful, but we'll jump straight into the action with your casting pair. It's Moses and Fiflaren. What have you got to say, boys?
What's going on, guys, here with Fiflaren? How's it going?
I don't know what to think anymore, Moses.
Yeah.
That's shit
harsh.
To bed completely.
that's rough. You never go full America.
No.
No.
Not at all. This is going to be interesting, actually.
Yeah, we talked about this.
Are you going to do play by play, or am I going to do play?
I think we'll just kind of mix it up.
Oh, yeah?
Just drop a lot of knowledge.
Yeah. Have you ever casted with a color caster before?
No, I haven't, actually.
Really? Is this the first one?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And it picked me. Yeah. Every single person.
Well, I knew, you know, you could raise the bar. That's what it is.
Yeah. Things about to get creamy.
Okay. It's over. I'm done. I'm out of here. Let's just call it a day.
What do you think about this match, Moses?
Yeah, this is really, because this is one of the, these two last two matchups that we have are the ones that we all thought might be able to go into this into that third map. We haven't seen it yet. I mean, this is, it's all going to depend on CLG on this map. This is, they have to win this. I mean, even Sean commented that when we saw the map rotation for this matchup, he was like, how's CLG letting Inferno through?
Yeah. And one thing for me to notice that it's going to be very exciting to see if Pete actually can do something about this team, right? CLG has always been the team where, kind of like how Liquid was the first game today, where they are so close to winning and then they just end up...
Yeah, the heartbreak round.
Yeah, right.
There's always one.
Right, there's always one. And then I wonder if actually Pete can, like, put him over the edge on that sense.
Well, especially very early on. I mean, he just came in here, what, like last weekend?
Last week.
Probably not very much practice, maybe like 2 to 3 days this week before traveling again and everything. So
I mean, they went up to the event in Toronto
as
well. Sure, CLG had a stand-in, but I think that's a really good event to start off with, right? Because they know, okay, what am I dealing with?
Yeah, and also, well, the one way he can help is, you know, that composure. Like CLG on the practice they've had so far is going to have to guilt themselves towards the finish line, but maybe he's the one who can make sure they have calm head, clear heads, and prevent that heartbreak from actually coming in. And yeah, with such short time, that's probably the biggest impact he can have. But I mean, we got to say, on the other hand, TSM, or XTSM, excuse me, Team Question Mark. They just had some questionable. They seem like when I watched some of their VODs coming up to this event, I was just like, they don't seem to be doing anything wrong in terms of tactically in the game. Mm-hmm. It's just like there are just situations where all of a sudden they just don't get the kills anymore.
Yeah,
and I think that more than anything is indicative of really, really weak mental game, mental confidence right now.
Yeah, and I mean, compared to before, they were always known as being a very strong group stage team, and even quarterfinals, and then obviously, you know, flunking out semis or even finals are not really winning anything. But that, they kind of went over the hump this year where they started winning tournaments as well, and now you see it back to how it used to be, but even worse since they, you know, they lost SK last weekend. And I don't know, maybe it's just a burnout, last event of the year obviously for them as well, so, but they should have this in the bag for me at least.
Yeah, I would agree with that, especially with Inferno being that second map. But either way, Semler said the knife round was going to be important and CLG wins it and takes that CT side, so that's a good start for them right off the bat, playing a pretty retake strategy on the same bomb site where Smoke is going to come out to block off jungle.
I really like this from CLG, because I mean, every single team out there, when they're on T side, they always end up going A, right? So just playing it retake is really smart. Just, yeah, let them plant, and then you go in with the nades that you have. You have a flash, you have nades as well, and a smoke from JDM. You can just smoke off the bomb side if you just want to try and defuse it.
Yeah, the key is finding a kill on this entrance with this retake, and there it is. Kerrigan goes up a little bit early. He gets taken out by JDM, but more aggression over towards the mid to connector, and all of a sudden it's down to this 3-on-3. Tarek's blocked off by smoke, and the bomb is going to get planted pretty soon. He has cover. I mean, he can be doing it right now, but you can see they're a little bit wary of someone peeking, so they actually fake it out, wait for that peek, and Hazed wins the battle. So down to a 3-on-2, and very, very tough spot for TSM to be in. Out of nades, that's going to get Tarek at the range. He wins that battle, and Zipnik's all the way in the back now. Not much he can do. He's got players everywhere. It's the triangle of doom.
Yeah, I actually don't understand why they didn't just plant. Sure, you saw the fake plant coming in, but when you have someone just guarding, and you know that you have long-range USPs, just plant the bomb and play it there. From there, right?
This is a really good execution of this retake, though. A nice shot from Zipnik. Oh, he gooshes as well. So FNS down to 6 HP. Got to be careful. Plenty of time to play with. So you can see another fake plant trying to, you know, see if Haze is going to be, or if anyone's going to be peeking up from that CT spawn again. And if he wins that duel, but he's brought so low. 3 HP now. No more mistakes for Zipnik. He has to hit everything immediately. That could be a good find if he can isolate FNS on top of the stairs, but he's not able to do it. And there it is. He finds him. FNS runs out wide. Tarek's got to be able to find this kill. And playing with the bomb side, Zipnik is going to get
it.
An incredible round, and already the heartbreak begins in round one.
Why? You saw the jump as well. Like, you never jump the site there when you're in a one-on-one situation, because obviously you have the penalty from jumping. He's just sitting there stationed as well. And you see, like, the jump here from Tarek.
Yeah.
It cost him the round. Yeah, it was a headshot here, but when you get put in a situation like that where you know you have the health advantage, you can just storm him, basically.
Yep. And it's such a shame, too, because actually CLG played that retake really, really well that entire time, up until that 2-on-1. So just an incredible, incredible round.
It was
round
even a 1-on-3.
Yeah. Just,
yeah.
Those are the mistakes that you just can't give up to these European teams. Like, that has to be a round win. But either way, a little bit of an investment into the second round. Hazed and FNS with armor and upgraded pistols. Tarek has the scout. No damage quite yet. And interesting enough, TQM, they only go for one SMG. So look for Kerrigan to be the one to head up first and scout, but it's going to be Dupree who falls to Hazed initially. Here comes the B hit. No one clears out FNS. He gets one kill, brings Zipnik's very low. He eventually gets cleaned out. And this is looking great for CLG. 5-on-2 now. And Device And Kerrigan, he had the bomb, but Kerrigan's got to get aggressive and mark it. And he's not able to find anything quite yet, taking a lot of fire. Eventually, he does fall. And Device, the last man standing, four members of the B bomb site for CLG, and Device has nowhere to go.
Yeah, and this is exactly what CLG needed. I mean, just mentally losing that pistol, which is a round that you should have won, right? Think of it this way. If they ended up losing the game with whatever, like 16-14, yeah. What do you think they're going to blame? Oh, the pistol round.
Yeah, they're going to go back to that.
Yeah. So now, I mean, winning back the eco is great for them, obviously. Especially after losing the pistol, which they really shouldn't have never done. For question mark, though, going B on an anti-eco, I never liked that idea. Like, you want to take over mid first, check out at least, smoke it off even, so JDM with the scout, you just get locked out to get some control first.
Right, yeah, exactly, and very much as well. And that was the thing, Kerrigan also had the SMG, and he wasn't the first one. He wasn't the one scouting anything out, so they lost some rifles very early on, and CLG's able to clean it out without losing anybody. So they get all these AK-47s and Galils for free. They don't have to spend any money into this round except for some armor and nades, so that's actually a really, really good round to win, especially with so many rifles on the board for TQM there, but a little bit of a battle. JDM not able to finish off Kerrigan. Now he knows there's another one jumping underneath him. Can't land that shot, but still a very good defensive hold. That nade does massive damage.
It's actually quite funny to see, because normally if you end up losing the anti-eco, you tend to buy it next round. You see here, Team Question Mark just buys, you know, some pistols, but they don't actually full buy, which is not something you see that it's not really that common anymore.
Yeah, it had to have been. That decision had to have come out from the fact they lost so many rifles. They're like, we're going right at AKs and Galils. It's not like they salvaged a P90 and an SMG.
And on top of that, it wasn't even close. So CLG, I think they survived with four?
Five
even. So, like, just buying there, yeah, sure, maybe. And this comes into play with, like, if you're an inexperienced team, you might actually just end up buying there anyway because you get frustrated. It's like, oh, can't believe we lost that. Just rebuy, win it back, right? Is that here you do have a smart play coming from Question Mark where it's like, well, just buy a bunch of pistols if you guys want, see what kind of money you have, and then just, you know, forget about that round.
Yeah, here's the dangerous part, though. Look at the economy on CLG. Because they, you know, salvaged four rifles, they don't have to spend any money in these two rounds. So
yeah,
at least on buying their guns, they pick up nades, but everyone is just skyrocketing in terms of their economy. So once again, it's going to be a save out of Question Mark. No armor picked up, only one smoke and one flash, and all of them heading towards the A bomb site very, very quickly. So this is going to be some kind of an execute. You know, best case scenario right now for TQM is they just want to get the bomb planted.
Yeah, and even then, I mean, they don't. Sure, it's a bonus, right? Because then you get the little 800 bucks, but we'll still be able to buy plenty next round, even an op on Kerrigan if he wants to.
Right, yep. And that'll be the big thing, too, is how's that op battle going to go? JDM, huge time opper for CLG, but there's the bomb plant. It's exactly what they wanted. What can they do from here? Kerrigan's going to push through, but he gets caught out by Cutler. CLG holding CT spawn very, very effectively in this round, not losing too much. It's only Haze who's fallen so far. Down to just two players is TQM, FNS. They've got to know where both of them are. There goes Page and B, and Device is going to get cleaned up by JDM jumping over with the scout. So good rounds for CLG, not losing very much once they won that second round, once they took it back from TQM, but not getting punished very much.
No, exactly. Yeah, sure. TQM, they didn't really have anything to work with, right? You have a flash and a smoke and some P250s, but getting the bomb down is key for them as well. They do opt to not go for a single op, though. And then for CLG's part, you did see the upgrade on JDM. He actually didn't really need to do that. When you have that kind of buy anyway, just keep the scout, save the money, right?
Yeah, see what comes of it, see what happens. And on the other side of the board, TQM, they do not have an AWP at all whatsoever. So JDM comes up towards the mid window. He's going to get smoked out, though, so ineffective. He's got to rotate off. An easy mid control for TQM. Kerrigan's already pushed his way up towards connector stairs. A lot of Molotovs out, but he's going to start sneaking and clearing his way in. And he's going to have a nice angle. Once this hit comes in on the A bomb site, once the execution, he's actually going to come right through the smoke, and Hayes spots it. So he gets the jump on that one, finds that first kill, but there he falls. JDM with the AWP chiming in. 4-on-3 now for CLG. And with this man in bed, actually gets tied up. Cajun finds one. So now they have a situation. They got to wait for these smokes to clear, but FNS gets it through the smoke. That was crucial. A very, very important kill. Slows down the plant.
Kerrigan should have just waited in connector there, that one round. Just end up planting there, because now even if you plant that way, you're not going to have someone in connector to actually. That's a bad plan for you then, essentially.
Right, and you can see, I mean, Cajun's just bombing flashbangs over towards CT spawn, providing cover when they have no smoke. And Cajun, this is a spot where you have to hit that first shot, and he does. He grabs JDM. The AWP is down. 2-on-2 retake situation. Device still in the site. Cajun knows one's at his flank. He can't win that battle, though, but Device has plenty of time to relocate his position. FNS, he's got to make his move quickly. Does have a kit. And now he knows exactly where Device is. He's going to jump up on top of Device very, very intelligently. He's not committing to these fights, biding his time, and there he commits to it. Sprays down FNS, gets their second round, and they're on the board. And he's even going to, just at the last second, you can see.
Yeah.
That's the worst when you throw your gun into spawn.
Yeah, but it was a good recovery, though, from question mark. Especially like I was talking about, like Kerrigan, for him, he should just stay there in connector. Like there was no CLG did not contest that at all. Just staying there, waiting for your teammates to hit the bomb site. You can just stay there and basically kill the guy that essentially killed your planner.
Right.
So then it leaves him in a better situation. Sure, they salvaged the situation anyway. Good job for them. And then now you see again here from CLG, since they were, so fortunate on not losing that many people on the ecos, they can actually buy again. And JDM with another off.
Yep. AWP for him. Still nothing on the TEQM side. You saw Device not able to salvage it there at the end of that last round. It's going to be a three-man defense at the A bomb site. So once again, full control of mid. There is one boosted up in towards the vents, it looks like. But Kerrigan's going to bypass him completely. He sees that vent isn't broken whatsoever. So he's just going to walk his way. And actually, no one from CLG, they have no clue this is coming. There's no eyes on this. Kerrigan is about to just ruin their day if he turns this corner looking at the bomb site. But he doesn't find anyone, but he's still in such a great position. Now he sees Haze fall back into CT spawn. And he's got to be so confused right now, he doesn't see any defense.
I mean, look at this. Now he's running, though.
Yeah, and Haze is going to clean that one up. So nothing comes from that kind of a position. And actually, now it's a little bit scary because he saw no one. They might not know Cutler's there whatsoever. He could play a huge role into this round. FNS, he does fall. There's where Cutler decides to peek. Sprays down the first one. Can't recover in time to get the second. 3-on-3 now. Holding strong, and Zipnix falls off the balcony. Not able to clean him out of position. And he's just biding time now. Now the rotations are in, all because Cutler cannot get cleared away. And even Haze chiming in with spam through the box. So this is collapse for TQM. Looks so promising once Kerrigan got into that spot. Just couldn't capitalize on it. And Cajun left in a 1-on-3.
Yeah, I'm going to call. Not much you can do here. Look at the time as well. But you saw the same situation again, actually, from Kerrigan. He comes in. Now he actually got boosted. You have that whole area, right? Why are you can't see anyone. Okay, so then, they're probably in spawn, right? So yeah. When you get that entry, I think Wazibek's got the entry in Palace, then just leave it. Just stay where you are. Because they have no idea where you are, right? So you're cutting off the rotation, and then you just plant again towards connector. You can put the smoke there down there if you want, and just Kerrigan has basically free pickings because, again, they have no idea where he is, right? Instead of just going in, you die, and then you have no control whatsoever.
Yeah, it cuts the map in half, essentially. And JDM and Device, they exchange fire, but it's Haze who's going to clean out Device, give themselves a man advantage. And this is a force buy for question mark. They do have an AWP, but it's all deagles and upgraded pistols with armor and nades behind it. So a lot invested into this round, and still three men over at A for CLG with this kind of a man advantage. They're really, outside of that opening pick from Haze, he falls away and they give up mid control once again, but no one from question mark has really taken advantage or probed against that right now. So rotating back towards that A bomb site, now they're dedicated to this hit.
Do you, have you watched CLG play Mirage as of late before PETA?
No. Oh yes, I've seen plenty of that, yeah.
So, we can probably wait until this situation.
Yeah, until Cutler, he's just going to man the bomb site once again.
Okay, there we go. So then question for you, right? If you just compare like the setups right now, where CLG just essentially just leaves mid as it is, they don't even contest the connector, they just leave it completely, right? Is that something new? Or is that something that they have done before, even before PETA?
It's normally when they challenge mid, it's when they have a double op setup. And they'll have, like, Taric with an AWP will get on catwalk. Mm. They'll sometimes have JDM and connector or window.
So otherwise, they never contest it.
Yeah, and well, actually, what's new from them is, finding that first pick and they fall away from it. A lot of times, it's like a battle where they stick to it. It's just fighting out there. But, I mean, that's smart. Just get that man advantage and fall away from it and use it. So, good stuff out of them. No armor on question mark, so this is a pretty big save round for them. That buy didn't work whatsoever, not even really being impactful and getting kills. So CLG now.
Look at the money as well, Tarek. 8 grand, and then you had one, I think it was Haste on 1.7, someone with 6.7 as well. So the money situation here is running away from question mark.
Yeah, especially when you force bind those rounds and you don't do enough damage. Nice find by JDM. Device peeks from underneath the corner of the smoke, but he finds it anyways. Bomb now coming up towards this A bomb site, up the ramp. No one spotted it quite yet. There's Cutler. Now he sees it coming. So now the rotations are going to be in full effect, but JDM's not ready for it. He was not aware that they were that advanced. So this is a scary spot for CLG to be in. Still a 4-on-3, and there's Tarek. He's going to save the day with one kill, and Zipnix doesn't have the health to take that fight. So CLG come in on the rotations, and they salvage the AWP as well. 6-2 now, and yeah, this could start to get away from question mark. Now it's, that question we talked about, a little bit of that mental toughness has seemed to have left them over the past few events, TQM. Can they come back from this one?
I mean, it's so weird because if this was any other team, like any other top team, I would always say yes, right? But considering that they've been struggling as of late, and I'm sure, you know, they probably had nightmares from even before. I don't know, like, they need to pick up a few rounds here, I'd say.
Well, this is when you need your stars. You need someone like Device and Dupree needs to have a huge round. Get them right back into this. But here's also the answer as well. TQM's like, okay, we get mid so easily when we throw that one window smoke. Let's just take it. We can do so many things from here. So once again, I mean, they're putting themselves in some good spots and they're not closing out the rounds, but use this mid control that's being offered up.
Here's here, Cajun. I mean, yeah, I completely agree with you because you have so many more options, right? It's just about being smart. Once you have mid control, like Cajun B here, he doesn't really necessarily have to peek.
Oh, but he's almost going to catch JDM with an 8 out, and he pushes the issue. JDM recovers in time with the AWP, a nice quick scope on a Cajun. Now Dupree's going to smoke him off, but what can he do from this spot? One more comes into window, and JDM's not ready for that one, so the equalizer is there, but FNS from Catwalk finds one of his own. So question mark, they're applying a lot of pressure, but they're getting punished when they don't commit to anything very, very quickly. Nice peek from FNS, and he's going to fall away.
I mean, 35 seconds left, and the bomb is still down T-spawn. Question mark have essentially like no real map control whatsoever. They do have an connector, and Kerrigan actually decides to take out counters. That's good.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great find for them in this 3-on-3 because now it spreads out the defense. Now the rotations are coming over towards the A bomb site, but they lose their anchor there. Haze falls. Now it's going to be a 2-on-3. There's some low HP players on the TQM side, but Tarek has the AWP to retake this with, so it's going to have to be FNS to find an initial kill to open up an opportunity for Tarek, and he misses that first shot, but still dedicated. Device, nice shot, close up, grabs the angle, gets the first kill, swings out, and is eventually going to clean out Tarek, who can't land anything with the AWP. Third round for TQM. And that's the thing, the big time player Device there at the end to get those last two kills. Got him on the board. Now they have to start stringing them together. They need to control this economy. If they lose this one, it's right back into CLG's favor. And you can see, we talked about the economy that CLG had built up from so early on in this half. Now it's dwindled. Now if TQM win, it might force a save.
Yeah, and you saw that. So look at CLG's approach there on the retake. TSM had, or question mark, had essentially no nades whatsoever, right?
Yeah, look at this mid aggression right now. They're switching things up. They lose that round. JDM's going to be the first one, and this catches TQM completely off guard. JDM with a triple kill. Great time to switch up the pace. We'll have to find out if that was maybe the PETA influence.
I really like that approach because they haven't contested mid whatsoever throughout the game, right? And then now that one round is like, well, let's switch it up now, right? We lost the one because they got map control, or they got mid control. Let's just push then and see what happened. JDM with three great kills. And just, you know, question mark, you were saying in the beginning of the round, they need to grind up some rounds now. So just like, if they had won this round, would have put CLG on an eco, right? Instead, you still let them with the, you still are not through the stretch where CLG, you know, will have a sloppy buy, right, or, you know, a forced buy. You're not there yet.
Right. And, you know, that push is a beautiful call, but even the call to just fall away afterwards, look at this, all five members back into the bomb sites. So they're not willing to risk getting picked off. JDM, he's in a spot to grab information if they're going to be dedicated to the A bomb site, but he's able to turn around very, very swiftly to support Tarek. And a little bit of a tough angle to deal with as the remaining TQM members encroach on this B bomb site. Nice shot from Device. He lands it. And even JDM falls. So all of a sudden, now it's on a retake situation. Now it's a scary spot to be in. And Zipnix, he only has 2 HP. That's the tough part. And there is going to be one CLG member flanking in those B tunnels, B halls, and Zipnix. He's got to hold Catwalk, but he can't land it quick enough. Only 2 HP Haze. That's an easy cleanup for him and Device. Last one left at the bench in a 1-on-3. Got to come up with some kind of a hero play. Can't land the first shot, and that might have just be it. Not able to get that kill. It's just a matter of time, and Cutler's going to be the one to clean him out. And plenty of time for the defuse.
Yeah, good job from CLG, actually, just waiting, taking their time, making sure that all of their players are there, and then you decide to just push them, right? So good job, because you did have someone in kitchen. Yeah, this is the JDM push, obviously, getting the 3 with the help of Cutler. But yeah, very, very actually cool and calm and collected, retaking that bomb site. Oh, I think most of the times, normally, you see that they go, that's why I always complain about when they retake the mouse and they go one by one, right?
Right.
There, it was just, okay, let's wait for one another. Doesn't matter, you know, don't get stressed because the bomb keeps on ticking. Just do it slow and methodical, and eventually, you know, we do, yeah, again, we see a push.
Yeah, this is just taking control of the map, and that's the second time. Zipnix not prepared for it, as his knife out, and even Cutler's in the site to slow this down, so their retreat is not cut off. Nades and Molotov string out, and that forces TQM to stay inside this choke point. Haze, plenty of an opportunity to find a kill, but he misses. It's the Tech 9 from Cajun who does it. And now all of a sudden, Tarek's feeling a little bit lonely under balcony. He's not going to win that duel. The Tech 9 of Kerrigan doing its work, and all of a sudden, this is shattered very quickly, but JDM finds the planter in the smoke, slows things down. And now they can gather themselves. FNS is now rotated over as well. No nades for TQM. Device has a Molotov to use, but he's just going to hide underneath Balcony while his teammate, it's going to be Dupree, who's making the rotate all the way around towards B bomb site. So plenty of time to work with, but Device has a long time to be patient and stay alive underneath this very exposed position.
Yeah, but this is very smart, though, because CLG know that they had that bomb, right? So then look at JDM. He's going to go, okay, well, maybe he's flanking right now. That's why it's a very smart move to actually go from B, because no one would be expecting that.
Oh yeah, this is the last thing that you can even tell. CLG, JDM might have checked the flank, but he didn't check the big one. Didn't check this massive flank. But now FNS has an inkling. Enough time has passed that he's gotten aware. Great game sense from him. Finds that kill, and now, Device, you've got a big job to do. Does find a smoke to use. And he's going to isolate JDM, go for this kill, but he's not going to win it. He thinks JDM... Actually, that's kind of a funny situation where JDM tries to jump up on stairs, misses the jump, and it actually saves him a little bit.
Yep. But I really like this from CLG. Just the you have the aggressive approach. You have the approach where, well, just play it very, very safe, very defensive. Just leave mid complete. Just play the bomb site. So you have both of these situations where it has worked out great for CLG and for question mark right now. Again, forced on a save, not really getting any control whatsoever. JDM with yet another obby, yeah, zero bucks. But you know, look at the buy, right? Right. Just support for CLG. Stay alive.
And they have given up the B bomb site completely. They have, I mean, this time they've switched things up consistently. A lot of mid control in these two rounds. Two people on Catwalk, Haze and Connector, and even JDM in window. They've just cleared everything out one by one. Nicely done from them, not taking any damage, being able to build up that economy. Device might be able to get a couple kills here, but the bomb is down in mid, so he can't even get a plant. Tarek's just going to clean him out. And here's the thing, TQM's composure at the opening of these rounds has been a little bit, you know, a little iffy. Because that push, they caught, JDM catches so many players with knives, and they spent so many rounds getting mid control for free. Great change of pace there, but then the next round when they push into the halls, I mean, Zipnix had his knife out as well.
Yeah. No, it's time now for question mark. It's like, just take your time a little bit. Yeah, you can take mid control, but just play a little bit more defensive in the beginning. Just hold your ground and just wait to see if CLG is actually pushing. If they're not, then you can take it over.
Now they're being a little bit more cautious with this mid control. Smoke comes out, but also a Molotov towards Connector and very fast pace. Two members get down. Tarek's boosted up, though, and another free kill for him. Has so many rounds in this that CLG's had an advantage of, and they're utilizing it very well, capitalizing on all these situations.
I mean, CLG, I think they're playing a really, really good CT side on Mirage here. Just always making sure that TSM second guesses them, or question mark.
JDM, nice pick, peeks into those upper B tunnels, finds Device, still a man advantage. And Cajun, he's going to jump into window, but Haze is right there and ready for it, punishes that. Now CLG complete control. Zipnix has got to do something coming up this A ramp. He's been spotted out by Cutler, and wisely, Cutler's not taking this fight. He's saying, okay, got to wait for some teammates to rotate over. We'll see how far you guys are willing to commit towards the A site. And now you can see that third member of CLG starting to cheat over. There's a good find from Kerrigan. Haze is the one that falls. So Cutler still mans CT spawn. That plant, that fake tap, lures him out of position, but he wins the battle anyways against Zipnix. And now, once again, in a one-on-three, a TQM member's got to come up huge. Kerrigan with the AK. He's going to push onto Cutler, but can't find it. Cutler playing so well in these situations. Very, very smart positioning from him.
Yeah, and if I was speeding now, again, anything, right? You're in the lead. It's 10-3. You're doing great. Now just take a deep breath, right? Just for this round, you don't have to push. You just play the bomb sites because you know that either question mark will just force fight or they will save. Right now, you see here, it's a little bit of a... Yeah, they have some money over. It's a half buy, whatever. Just play it safe here. Just make sure that, again, don't do any unnecessary risks. Just take over bomb sites together or retake bomb sites together. And then coming into 11th round, maybe you want to even play defensive there as well because you've been very aggressive throughout the last 5-6 rounds of the half.
Yeah, you've had some very, very aggressive plays, some success, but let's not have that heartbreak come back. And this is the more incredible thing is that we haven't mentioned in some time is they lost the pistol round. And it's 10-3 for them. So Kerrigan, now he's in the Tech 9. He gets in the window room but can't win the battle. Once again, CLG members holding strong, except Cutler and Haze. Immediately as I say that, they just fall. The defense gets shattered. Dupree with big plays. Here it is. Here's the heartbreak. What could be just a dominating half. TQM is taking control of this round. It doesn't look like there's going to be any avenue into this retake for CLG in a 2-on-4.
Yeah, I mean, you saw that JDM missing that op shot should never really happen, right? Losing the round, this is like you're saying as well, it's like a heartbreak round, right? Where you're playing so well throughout the half, and then you end up losing to not even a force buy. It was the Tech 9 and two people had armor, and that's it. There was nothing else. So now, now the mental part comes in, right? Just reset, come into the last round of the half and just end up winning that, and you're in a very good situation, right? 11-4, nothing to worry about. If you win the pistol, great, but it's not really needed at that point.
Right. Well, I mean, here's the thing, too, is for how good this half has looked for CLG, TQM would love to get away with 5 rounds here. That would be quite an incredible feat. Either way, this time around, it's going to be that full buy. AWP on device, AK-47s. You can see just spamming some Tech-9s under the ground because he has so much money in case any of his teammates need an upgraded sidearm. And here's the double op setup for CLG. So once again, going for a switch up. Tarek's going to get aggressive at Halls. He's going to grab an angle, but no one's going to be there from TQM. They're taking the bomb towards the B bomb site where FNS is all alone. And even just one player grabbing control at the top of mid. Haze is going to be the one who might be able to spot him out, but Kerrigan walking. Haze doesn't know he's gotten by. This is, once again, Kerrigan's found himself in a very sneaky position to be effective. And here comes the B hit. FNS is focused over towards the B tunnels, and he falls to Kerrigan coming up cat. Great take from TQM. Shatter the defense so quickly, and now Kerrigan just going for more. And all of a sudden, I mean, last round of the half, but there's real no way that this retake is going to happen for CLG in a 2-on-4. Cutler's got to find something early, and he's not. Device has the angle. Long range of that AWP just cuts it off. And now Tarek, you got to go for it. Misses the flashbang just a little bit, and Dupree's going to be already in there. Very, very nice half for CLG. Actually, a very impressive half from CLG, but TQM still getting away with 5 is good.
I mean, considering that CLG let TQM move up mid, you saw Kerrigan 2 rounds, one in connector and one get boosted without being noticed, and then last round there, walks up catwalk, Haze just completely misses him, right? And then you end up losing the B-bomb stuff because you... Like, for Haze, it's like, mid is clear, don't worry about it, because he shot FNS. He was just standing there, aimed towards B-bomb side, just having his back towards catwalk, just ended up dying, right? So it's still very impressive for CLG, having 10 rounds, despite, you know, not making sure where the Team Question Marks players are.
Yeah, and you saw the stats there up for JDM, 170 ADR, doing some good work with that AWP. Thank you, the Score Esports, for those stats they provided. And now into the second half, pistol round, 5-10. And you can see Zipnix, he's just going to get aggressive. He sees no pressure in Halls, and he's going to push all the way up. But it's Dupree that finds that kill. They do a two-man push, and Haze gets baited into peeking, and he falls quickly. And CLG, they look like they want to put a little bit of pressure on, but the catwalk prong of this attack is not here yet. It's just going to be one member now. And Zipnix trying to bide his time, and they land the shots. The rotation is in. You can see, look at TQM, 4 members here, and this is going to get shut down out of CLG.
Yeah, only having... The guy that went down, did he have a smoke or nothing? Just armor?
Yeah.
Yeah, so only having two flash, well, decos as well, but 2 flashes hitting the B bomb site. Just use one of them, and question mark, very smart. They're just playing a very passive, getting the entry, just dropping down, and just work together on the bomb site. For CLG, like you're talking about as well, they didn't really wait for the catwalk guy, right? So they pushed B, and then catwalk came a little bit too slow. And then it wasn't really quite synchronized.
One of the T-side pistol rounds CLG has loved on this map is one going towards A and 4 in those B tunnels. So maybe TQM with that quick rotate, you know, that's something they scouted a little bit. But now, buy up into this second round, except for JDM, who's the AWPer. He's saving the armor to try and have that in the fourth round. And you can see, trying to take these range battles with the pistols, it's not working out. This is a completely different style of mid-defense that we're seeing out of TQM. 3 members peeking, 1 from connector, 1 catwalk, and 1 window, and they shut everything down.
Yeah, I mean, that's the beauty of Mirage as well, when you have so many options. You can either contest A, or you can play very defensive, you don't really bother with mid, but you play retake A as well, or you can push mid and you just leave A and try and retake that way as well. That's what question mark is really, it does a good job with, where you never really know what they're going to end up doing. And that's something that you saw actually CLG do previous half as well, which is something you haven't really seen before. So I'll be very, very now for CLG moving forward on the first weapon round here. Just make sure you don't get caught off guard, you're sticking around a little bit, and then just see what question mark does. If they contest mid, okay, sure. Then what's going to happen, right? They're going to retake A. Then just make sure if you do end up hitting that bomb site, that your position is great. Maybe even push CT spawn.
Eric's going to get that opening kill onto Kerrigan. So it is a 5-on-4, but there's no armor, there's no nades on the CLG side, so they've got to get much more of that, and Device is going to equalize things, spraying down onto FNS. They'd love to get a plant here. It is a little bit of a retake strategy, but like I said, there's no smokes on the CLG side, so I mean, they can't block off any of these rifles, and it's just going to be easy pickings at range. Cajun actually commits very, very wide to this fight, and he's just going to tap away. Device comes in, clean up some of those kills, give Cajun some nice assists, build up that stat.
Yeah, just trying to do some damage towards Team Question Mark here. Nice job by Session Target.
I thought the same thing when it actually happened.
I was like, did you really get on aimed by a Gawker right now? But Tarik actually had the P250.
It looked fantastic, though.
Yeah, so the first buy here, obviously, you have the Offman Kerrigan. He's known for being a great offer on this map. Just, I mean, he's good overall, but this map, he excels at.
And JDM has it on the other side, so, you know, not investing in armor now. He's got it. So could be a little bit of a duel, and actually Kerrigan with this angle, I don't know if Hayes did spot him, so he forces him back. Some nice spam through the edge of that wall, just puts enough pressure on Kerrigan. He's down to 57 HP and falls away. So now we have mid control, and that's a miss smoke. So that does not go where they wanted it to. And now they're not blocked going up catwalk, so they have to readjust.
Yeah, it's a very important smoke to actually miss, because now you have to spend one more there, and if you want to, you know, get connector control, and then you see here, you see bomb moving towards A. You need those two smokes to cover off CT spawn and stuff, right? So,
well, you can see they called it off. He just said, I missed the smoke, I'm coming back. We're just going to do four men towards A. So, there's an important prong of this attack that's missing is someone coming or lurking up connector. There is one over towards the B bomb site. He's alone, and that might be for a very, very big flank later on in the round. But now the execution comes out. TQM drops a Molotov on top of the ramp, but Hayes runs right through it. And Cutler's going to get the first kill on a device. And they still haven't cleared out one member on the balcony, and that's Cajun. He's going to find one. He gets a second crucial play from Cajun. Very, very patient. But now everyone else from TQM blocked out by the smoke. Hayes has control. CT spawn finds that kill, and Dupree very quickly is the last man left on stairs. And he's got three people to deal with. And there it is. FNS finally comes in with that flank coming from connector, and that's the first gun round for CLG.
Yeah, and I mean, great job from CLG. Like you were talking about as well, FNS missed the smoke. They end up calling it off, going towards A instead. Exactly what I was talking about. Haste pushes down CT spawn to get more control. Love that.
Yeah.
That's perfect, because if you don't do that, he's going to come from CT spawn and just going to get sandwiched, right? Run from connector or jungle and then from CT spawn. Instead, take control. You end up winning that fight, and then it's basically a round one, right? You have so much control of the bomb side and the actual whole A of A side, you can't retake that.
Yeah, it's so difficult if there's a terrorist in that CT spawn. So you're right, very, very smart play. But another miss.
Missing nades.
Yeah, device missed that nade in window. The Molotov from CLG comes out, hits a fence post. So a little bit goofy with these grenades. But either way, once again, CLG, maybe, I don't know if it's because of that Molotov, but once again, it looked like they wanted to go up catwalk, and now they just reconvene back towards the A bomb site. Very similar to this last round. Four members dedicated to this A hit. Tarik with the AWP. This is double up on the T side. Yeah, I don't either.
For especially Tarik, why you go all by yourself with an AWP there? If you end up going down there, and then you have Cajun with B with the buy. Yeah, exactly here. Now you essentially just, now you have no control. You have one over up in mid, and you have three guys just waiting to hit A.
Yeah, you relinquish map control. Now you get punished for trying to take over halls late. So 5-on-4, Cajun in much the same spot he was in last time, on top of the balcony. The bomb for CLG, though, has gone back towards the B bomb site. So they've swung it around the map, and this might be a situation. They're going to send one player. That's Hayes. He's going to go up ramp. He's got to find kills, and he's got to do it quickly. He's got to make some kind of a presence. Just spamming through the smoke isn't going to do it. Now Kerrigan's going to punish him, but now they know. They say, all right, we got that one kill. No one else is here. And now you're going to start seeing Device on his horse. He pulls out the knife. He's rotating already. FNS coming up catwalk. He's going to slip by the rotation, but already the attack in the B halls is just getting demolished. JDM with the AWP can't do anything quite yet. Zipnix is going to find that angle over by Van. He's going to get the second kill as well, and he's someone that Device actually mentioned has been playing very, very well these past few months.
Yeah, and with Tarik going down there, I really like the approach. That's a Peter call right there, where they hit the A bomb site, they win it, and next round, just do essentially the same thing, but you fake it towards B, right? If Tarik would not have gone down there, then it would essentially have two guys that would be faking, both Haste and Tarik there. Tarik with the AWP, watching Palace, and the Haste just walk up. Instead, now he goes down, and then you essentially just have one dude running up A with an AK. You're not going to fall for that fake.
Yeah, that doesn't really do anything, especially Haze didn't even get any of those kills. But there's Kerrigan still with the AWP. You mentioned it, you brought it up. Kerrigan being a very, very good offer, especially on Mirage. And here he is exerting some dominance in these past few rounds. There's a little bit of mid control for CLG, but TQM has pretty much confined them to what they have, not letting them gain any more ground. And now Dupree feeling very aggressive, going hunting for some of these eagle kills. He's gonna jump down, he grabs the first one and the second. Three kills for him on the round. So 11-10 now, CLG still in the lead, but it's dwindled.
Yeah, and here's the decision now, where it's like, oh, we can buy. I mean, you get the AKs, you get the some smokes and stuff, or you end up half buying, essentially what CLG is doing, where you get the Tech Nines, you get smokes and flashes, even Molotovs and armor, right? And then you can, even if you end up losing this round, which is great, you can still buy, and you still have an AWP and JDM if you want to.
Right, and you still have that ability to deal economic damage, keep the money for the CTs in check, but that's not going to be a good start. Device just spraying through the smoke at the corner, finds that first kill, the Molotov comes out to prevent him from doing it again, and now they're going to send two up connector, two up the A ramp. Is there going to be any success in this device? In the smoke, he gets caught. He runs right into JDM, and JDM's aware of it first, but some of the kills come out. So actually, Cajun, once again, just hiding in closet, bides his time, finds two kills, and it's all down to Cutler, who's made his way towards CT spawn, grabbed control, but there's nothing that he can do with it from here. There is one member, Dupree, very, very low, but Cutler, he's got to win this duel first, and he's actually dealing the damage, and he spins around but can't connect onto Dupree. So 11-11 now.
Yeah, getting two kills, probably not what they were hoping for. At least try to go for a plant, right? So even if you end up losing that round, you can essentially lose this one as well. You can still do a little bit of a buy. But yeah, again, it's a good buy here from CLG. You have the AWP on JDM. You have all the nades. You have mollies as well. You even have three molotovs here. So probably going to see a well-executed round here where you use one smoke or one molly in the sniper's nest here and the other two just to take control somewhere else.
Delayed mid control. They do have the smoke in window room, so device is going to be completely blocked off. FNS coming from underground, so this time there's not too much aggression here from TQM to protect this kind of mid pressure. JDM is going to start making his way up catwalk. He's encroaching on FNS, going to go back towards the B tunnels. The bomb is still undecided at the top of mid, but I mean, once again, TQM, they've given up mid, but they contain it. And there's device finding a nice angle in that smoke to get the opening kill. That's got to be frustrating for Haze.
Yeah, and that's why you want to use the Molotov there. After first smoke, throw in the Molotov when you already have it anyway, because then you can actually, you're not going to put him in a situation like that.
Yeah, but good kills come out. Device with one more. Cajun also really whittling down the CLG before they can even, you know, decide where to execute to, before they can even get in the late round situation. This defense is looking so strong. The wall has been put up, and CLG has no answer right now. I mean, they're getting some of this mid control, but it's like TQM says, please get mid control, and we're going to pounce on you at this certain point. When we know you're at the base of connector, we're just going to start pouncing and just destroy you.
Yeah, and I mean, this round here, this is the point of time where you want to call a tactical timeout, right? Maybe not this round you're going to be saving, but you want to make sure that you use it.
Your next gun round, because you've been cleaned out. I mean, what do you do against this kind of a play when you're having, when you have that mid control? I mean, it's the same question that TQM had to figure out in the first half. They have mid control, but what do you do with it when even though you have it, you're still getting just demolished afterwards?
Yeah, I mean, you get a little bit paranoid, right? Because you're thinking, oh, if we get mid control, we're going to win the round. Well, it's not really that easy, but you want to do something with having the mid control. And you don't want to just split B, for example. As long as you have it, you can just make sure that they know that you have mid. You don't have to do anything with it. Then you can fall back, hit B, hit A even. But just so they get very, very nervous that you're even in mid, will just cause the rotate to be very delayed.
Yeah, you keep them honest. Keep them frozen in those positions. And right now, TQM, they're not backing down from any fights in this anti-eco, and they're shutting down CLG. Bomb is approaching this B-bomb site. JDM's not going to win that battle, though, in Zipnix. Once again, using his movement so efficiently at this B-bomb site prevents a plant.
Yeah,
allows his teammates to get there. Yeah, this might be where you have PETA behind him, just, you know, saying this is where we want to do it. But
yeah, I mean, it's 13. You're not going to see it anyway, which is, I really don't like this, because, again, you have to keep in mind you do have that timeout. And if you're in this situation now where you do not win the T-rounds you need to win, then you need to call a timeout. You need to figure things out. Like, what have we tried? What have we tried? Okay, let's try something we haven't yet tried. Or something that, okay, we messed up there. Let's try it again, because it was working. It's just that we didn't execute, or we didn't, you know, execute properly on the bomb side.
Yeah, either way, this is going to be tough. CLG still with just one gun round in this half. This is a little bit new. Runs a little bit into the Molotov, but they're not, you know, dedicating themselves to this mid control. There's what you talked about. Brilliant. It works perfectly. Kerrigan has to try and get out of there, and JDM picks it off. Maybe they're listening to you, Fiff.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe I'm just... Maybe they're on... Oh, they don't have anything on the PCs, actually.
Yeah. Nope. They got nothing. So, either way...
Got nothing.
Whatever it might be, telepathically, they do exactly what you say. It yields them the first kill, and now you can see it just kind of waterfalls from there. That first kill opens up the floodgates. Cutler gets a second one, and all of a sudden, a minute left in the round and a 5-on-3, and CLG can slowly just strangle onto any bombsite they want. Cajun gets aggressive. Tarek almost doesn't clear it, but swings over just in time, finds that kill. A bombsite is open for the taking. Device is going to try and rotate over, but he's not going to get there in time. And CLG have a really, really strong hold in this match. And now, I mean, Device is even smoked off now, so he might have to go for a jump up, try and kill the planter. JDM had the angle, but the timing, he looks away just in time, and Device can't land either shot. And now it might be a call to save here for TQM.
Yeah, I mean, they should. Bombs down, 2-on-5 situation. Kind of weird that CLG ended up planning the way they did. Sure, I mean, again, 2-on-5, but when you have connector, you have cavalry, you have everything. Just play it safe in terms of plant correctly, just in case you end up like falling, because then there, all the 3-4 guys that you have over here, if they end up defusing, they're not going to be able to do anything.
Yeah, I was just about to notice that they were all rotating and evacuating the bomb site to a position where they didn't have eyes on the bomb, so Risky situation, but still, Device just stuck around to try and deal some economic damage, get two kills, keep their money low, make them rebuy. So if they do win, they do get themselves up towards 14 rounds, it'll be a very, very weak, very much weaker buy for CLG. Either way, CLG, that's the first gun round in, it was five straight for TQM before that round, or six straight.
Five. Yeah, great round by CLG. As I was saying, Molotov off the sniper nest. Kerrigan just ended up dying, right? And like you were saying, the waterfall, right? After he dies, what does every team do when they're in a deficit? They want to chase. They want to equalize the score. And that's exactly what happened. And CLG, they were prepared. So then it was a 5-on-3. Tarik, great job there. Now with the A side as well. 5-on-2 and then ended up in the round.
And being aware that they didn't have map control of that portion, making sure he cleared every corner. So now, CLG very much dedicated to a B hit. This time it's four members in these B halls. One over towards mid is going to fall back now, but here it comes. Zipnix, he's got a big job to do. He misses a flashbang, but doesn't matter. Haze jumps out. That's the bomb. So now they have the full rotation on. They don't have to be scared. And TQM, Zipnix is just a beast in this situation. And how is he going to get cleaned out? Hey, look at this. He's making it so if they want to clear him out of that spot, they have to swing wide, and that put him in the crosshair of his teammates. Such a strong defense. CLG gets cleaned out.
Yeah, I really don't like that that round from CLG. Winning the previous round, trying to do something new, where it's like basically walk into B, but then they got spotted, and then they... And B is very hard to do that with, because the stretch that you have to run after you get spotted is actually very, very long. So then you have all the time, Sipix as well, doing a great job there, and you saw the rotation coming in from Kerrigan as well, so... Bit of a sloppy round, I'd say, from CLG. They probably could done a lot more work if they just stuck with the default.
Yeah, now after that very, very strong first half, it's all onto this round. 12-14, they do buy up into it. AWP on JDM, Tech-9s and Deagles and P250s on the rest of them, but they're really, really going to have to look for JDM. That star opper, he's the one who's got to have an impact. Find him some kind of an opening, get a first kill, and he's confined to the A-ramp. That AWP hasn't really put it into play yet, so they're going to execute up the A-ramp, and hopefully he can just stay far back as his teammates run up, and they're just hoping that he picks off any kind of defender that swings out too wide.
Yeah, I mean, this round, I would love to see that the previous round. Because this one is not something you've done before. And question mark, look at the positioning. Very retakey, kind of way. You only have one guy contesting.
And Cajun's been very, very patient in those positions. And there it is, Kerrigan swings wide. He gets one, but not worth it. Haze trades him off. But the rest of the attack has been stalled out. One Molotov has just slowed this down incredibly. And now it's JDM's turn, and he might be able to catch him off guard if they're saying, you know, that was a pistol, but it doesn't matter. Device is there. He's going to win the first one. He's going to win the second one as well. Just being whittled down, and now Cutler, he's got to do something in mid. He's got to flank, but he's got to be a little bit more aggressive than he'd like to be and make the play to alleviate pressure on Haze.
Yeah, Haze is going to end up going down here as well. Yeah, I like the approach from CLG. I actually thought that they, even despite the molly, that they would just wait and like hope that question mark thinks it's a fake and rotates back. Because they did have two flashbangs to use after. But when JDM peaks without the flashbang, he goes down, and then one more person goes out, and that's when he used the flashbang. It's a little bit too late.
Yep. And I mean, it's very good defense as well by TQM. You know, just waiting for that execute, waiting for the smokes to start flying over the walls, and like, all right, we're just going to drop a molly in the choke point.
Yep.
Run through it if you want. And CLG doesn't. And then that applies time for the rotations for different positions to come out. And now they're on five Tech Nines. Dupree's aggressive up mid. They haven't seen that yet, but he doesn't get anything from it. It's Zipnix who finds one onto JDM. And now Cajun's still aggressive towards the air. That's the bomb. Now rotations are going to start coming in, but Cajun's going to get a second before falling. 3-on-1 now as Device has cleaned out Cutler. So this half of this map looked so good for CLG at the beginning. And now it looks like it's all over unless Haze can pull off something special here. He does have the bomb and a minute to work with, and he has a position where he can go to either bomb site. But actually, look at Zipnix. Always aware, eternally aware. He's going to deal the damage, and he's going to find the kill in the end. So 16-12 for TQM is first map. That was CLG's pick on Mirage. First half looked great for them.
Yeah, and I actually just look at their approach to the game as well. That's why I thought that they, PETA, despite just being there for a week, right, actually found some stuff to work on. And then coming into T side, first off, when you notice that, okay, you only win two rounds on your T side, but we noticed when you end up losing the pistol and the three rounds, you win the fourth round, and then it just escalates, right? You end up losing five straight rounds, call for a timeout, because obviously something is not working. If you end up losing five straight rounds and you don't have a reply to it, then something, you know, you need to figure something out.
Yep, and they never end up using that timeout, and I'm sure that's what the analysts are going to be talking about over on the couch. So take it away, Machine.
It is like the Mr. Smith quote. You know?
We certainly can dissect that one a little further, Moses. Thank you very much for yourself and for Flaren for map one there going the way of TQM and doing so. In quite a convincing style in that second half. What a first half from CLG, though, as they managed to... I mean, we were actually... The main discussion we were making was, I mean, 10-5, 11-4, that extra round could have really made a world of difference for the American side. Anders.
Why the hell didn't they win it? Because the round that they gave that up on wasn't even like a brilliant round out of the Danish side. It was just like, the pistols, and then they just end up winning it. It's so painful.
Does it not feel like this is just the same story again and again, Blue? It doesn't stop.
So close for North America, but nothing being gained from this one, unfortunately.
So let's look at this objectively. Like, what were they doing wrong? Like, what happened?
I mean, the first half, everything goes great, and it's just in the second half, everything just falls apart, unfortunately. They have this great lead, but then they immediately start to drop the ball from that point forward, and the mistakes just start piling on top of each other, which, again, gives the lead back over to TQM, and then they just take the victory from that point forward.
This was a pretty clear example of, like, how CS can be structured up, you know? When it's not like Envy, who are winning four spies and just throwing everything out of whack, and it turns into this. This is... TQM winning the pistol, winning the rifle, and then, oh, game is tied again, guys. You know, and it's just like, and they're just looking so solid that it just feels inevitable. It just feels like it is not going to stop.
And I'm guilty of that as well. Like, you see 10-5 and you're like, wow, CLG, this is it. Here we go, three mapper. And then actually all of a sudden that second half happens and you, like, those rounds just go like that. Like, you blink and you miss it. All of a sudden you're right, it's tied 10-10. I mean, they had what? The pistol, two buys, and we were level. Like, that was kind of all CLG could really bring in. So, like,
man, it is just really painful to watch NACS.
They even had some. They even had some good
shots.
They had some good answers, I think, to some of the stuff that was being thrown out. Some of the smokes, again, we pointed this out before the game went live as well. Those smokes that landed in the window, the Molotov in the connector, that's become like the standard opening for taking mid control. Once you're on the terrorist side, you just smoke window, you throw a Molotov into connector, and then anyone playing AWP on the other side is not going to have a fun time. And CLG actually come up with some good answers. Like, you saw JDM pushing top mid, three people with him. They had a double push on catwalk, right? So they had some creative ways of trying to, like, deal with that whole issue, and it still wasn't enough. I mean, it still turns out that those smokes are still just too good. This is one of the rounds here. Good job on production here. This triple push here, right, is meant to directly counter. You can see the window smoked here, and if they hadn't been killed, all of them, by JDM, then they would have thrown them on themselves in the connector as well. And that would have denied any kind of mid control, which is all that, you know, TQM wanted.
But you started to see it really as well, because, like, then the next step behind that Molotov is smoke up onto short, then you start pushing ladder room, then you start, you know, messing around there on the T side. And CLG, we're coming up with ways to deal with that short smoke. We saw a round where Tarik gets boosted up immediately. The smoke
I
goes down,
that,
boom, he gets boosted up onto the boxes.
So
he's
cool.
Looking into mid,
right.
He gets a kill, spots some info, falls. It was just like you're just thinking,
this
oh boy,
so
yeah, we got a game. Like, this is possible.
They're doing
you know?
It. They're doing right. it.
And then.
All of that goes to show exactly what we've seen earlier when it's been, like, I think when it's been cut, like, being a little bit more involved, and even if it is, like, if FNS is sitting in the middle right now, just the fact that they're willing to put in the work, you can tell. I'm sure, even if Cutler's no longer leading, I'm absolutely sure he's still doing a lot of work and looking at demos and stuff like that. He has to, like, continue. I don't think you can stop doing that once you start doing it. Like, it becomes too important, right? And playing on the CT side, it's so much easier to look at demos, right? But once you're playing on the terror side, you can do some of these things. But once you're playing on the CT side, it gets a little bit tricky, right? And that's what they ran into.
That's when, once it started getting into the danger zone of, like, okay, TQM, they're tied up now. They've got a good economy. The pressure really started to set in on CLG. That's when it felt like they started making those mistakes again.
The big thing.
Are you thinking about Haze? Because I'm thinking about Haze. That round on B where
he didn't peek out very quickly.
Jumped straight out. No, that's another one as well.
Oh, sure. Terry coming out of B apartments. I think that was the big thing. Yeah. Where it was like the Hail Mary play. And you when it starts turning into pushes where the first man out, it's almost like watching Freiburg on Nip. You know, it's like he's like, I'm going to do it, guys. He goes out. He's like, guys, anyone? Team, like, where is everybody, right? You know, you can't have, you know, your first man into the site and then 3 seconds later the next man show up. Like, you need to have this. This is where you start to really see, like, the Fanatics, the Envies, when their entry man, he goes in first, and then he knows he's got two guys on his ass right behind him, and they're going to get that trade frag, and then you just crush onto that site. That's how it's supposed to go.
Right.
You don't run in and drips and drabs and just let yourself get picked off one after another.
And And you know, yeah, to just want to kind of bring up CLG's kind of the things we can commend them on was the fact that we could hear them talking, and actually
comms were good.
The comms were really good. Tight. It was good, especially on their CT side. We did lose them a little bit on the T side, wouldn't you say?
I mean, the biggest thing that would have really allowed CLG to get back into that match and keep that lead going strong into the second half would have been if they were able to restrict XTSM's economy right from the beginning. But they failed to do that. XTSM started off strong, and they pretty much continue strong for the rest of that half. So they don't have this advantage. And then again, they ran into that problem that you were talking about before, where they just don't really have that courage or that overall that willingness to push out onto the sites and whatnot. So they get timid, and Conquest did this a lot versus Fnatic as well in that last set. But they just sit themselves either inside of the apartments or wherever they're pushing out from. They never really make any progress, and then they're just slowly picked off one by one by the members of XTSM.
And I mean, one of the interesting observations we made, I think we need to start talking about map two before we run out of time. But I did want to bring up the whole kind of device play mid more than Kerrigan was. But you know, because the whole point I made was like, I love Kerrigan on CT side. He was actually kind of vacant. It was always device. He was left to his own devices on that one. Oh, see what I accidentally did there.
Kerrigan wasn't. He was. Once he got that off, he actually was key to me because he was so difficult. Listening to CLG, they're trying to guess, like, okay, where's he going, right? And Kerrigan, it's almost like fighting games, right, where it's like you train your opponent into certain habits, and then you break that habit, just catch them off guard. So Kerrigan kept going mid connector every time. And so CLG, at this point, they're like, okay, where's Kerrigan? Oh, he goes connector every round, right? No, he's up in B apartments waiting for Taric to push in, and boom, he kills him there. Oh, no, he's up in Palace, and he wins the duel again versus Taric when they had two ops on CLG's side. He was all over the place, Kerrigan. He wasn't just sitting in mid. He was really doing a fantastic job of making it really difficult for CLG to predict where that op was. And so CLG just kept losing a guy. They just, you know, it was always top priority
for them. They needed to try and find him. That's where it gets
truly frightening. And especially for CLG's side, you know, you have to, it got to the point where Peter has to walk up and be like, are you comfortable taking a fight with Kerrigan mid?
He did say that.
Because, you know, you're going to have to shut him down somehow. And, you know, you need to be able to have the confidence to go up against him one on one and win that duel. So I think that's the main thing. It's just that CLG, it's a confidence question. As soon as the road gets rocky for them, they really struggle.
Well, you heard it from Semler. It's a confidence question. Let's see what they had to say, how confident they were feeling when we spoke to them earlier on today.
Ah.
I'm FNS, and I play for Team Counter Logic Gaming. I think overall, as a team, we've grown a lot. In game and outside. We had a good start. We were like 5-1 and then kind of progressed onwards. I would like to think that we'd make top four. Question Mark is probably the most difficult team to play in our group. They just came off a rough loss, and overall they haven't been playing that well, so hopefully we have a good chance of beating them. If we can make it past the group, I think we could win the event. I think skill-wise, I don't think we'll have a problem against the European teams. I think it overall comes down to tactics, and if we can match up there, then the NA team should be able to do a good job. I'd like to see Liquid do really well. I think they're doing a pretty good job of progressing throughout the scene. They've proven themselves at an international caliber, which they hadn't done before, so it's pretty impressive to look at. We'd like nothing more than for us to upset and for other North American teams to upset Europeans too.
And so, I mean, confident words there from Finesse or FNS, whichever way you want to cut it. He's saying, you know, if we win the group, we can win the event. I mean, yeah, I mean that makes sense, dude. But you got to do that. You got to do that first step. Of course, winning this match. The next map we'll be going into is Inferno, and I'm gonna have to poke you guys for some quick predictions so we can jump straight into the action. Going, working my way down the line then, Blue. What are you thinking?
As much as I would like to, again, throw confidence towards North America, the problem is that this map is just going to throw way more over towards the guys over on XTSM, so I have to swing my prediction now over to the other side, and I think the guys over here on Team Question Mark are going to take map two, and it'll be 2-0.
I think we came to that conclusion going into the first map. It's just that Mirage had to be the key map for CLG to take this to three maps, so I'm going to stick by Team Question. Well, I think their Inferno is just superior right now.
Same, only outside chances if they win the knife and have like a lockdown CT half. Like that's the only thing they could do here. They got to get like 13 rounds or more on CT side. That then it's possible.
Okay, so the caster couch says there's no question that Question Mark will be taking this one. We're going to find out straight away. It's going to be Moses and Van Flaren who are ready to dive into our second map here in the best of three.